See, man, I ain't tripping off none of my homeboys. No. And I ain't tripping off none of her girlfriends.
Don't trip, Rafi.
Because I can't do that. We're going to be together. We're going to do this.
Get up.
No, we can do this.
Just me and you. Ooh, baby.
If you didn't follow the established path, if you did the unexpected, would you feel scared, proud, relieved? Could you explain that helping the people of Peru improve their own community would also have an effect on your own? Or assisting an entrepreneur in Ukraine to launch her small business? Or creating a support group in Malawi for children orphaned by AIDS? What if you established your own path, one that others might follow? Would you rather make your own way or spend your life saying, what if? Life is calling. How far will you go? Peace Corps. To find out more, call 1-800-424-8580. or go to PeaceCorps.gov.
Vibes Live coming at ya.
So exciting, but she couldn't define enemy from friend to be. All she wanted to see was that intimacy. Smile for me, baby, smile for me, baby. Why your vision's so blurry and your smile so hazy? I see that mascara wearing off. It smears every time a tear drop.
Smile again. I know the times are tough, but smile for me. I know this world is crazy.
Smile. Smile, smile for me, for me, for me. Hope it's romantic, trying to show a better days. As a feather way back in them letterman wearing days. Young love, young buck, pretty girl strutting in them pumps. Every other week she had a different man dump. Maybe she's searching for something better in a different weather. Expectations high, depicting who comes up. Searching for that one man, man, she won't let up. Why? I look instead, I need a close up. I'm tired of the sideline, I'm trying to make you mine. She says a friend's a friend, ain't that crossing the line? Maybe it is, or maybe it begins something great. Where I make you smile again, you know?
Smile again. I know the times are tough, but smile for me. I know
yeah. Dream chasers, heart takers, smile on the world, let's see where that can take us. Your smile's an art, in life it makes a mark. If they painted it clearer, maybe this vision would be vivid. Smile again, I know the times are tough, but smile for me. I know this world is crazy. Smile, smile, smile. For me, for me. Takeover, man. Z Will, LCM, you dig?
Let's go.
That's the limitation, the innovation, the patience, the information is double due to higher elevation. I'm going hammy for Grammys, I will be part of that family. These suckers, they try to brand me, they simply don't understand me. I bet they'll hate it the day that we said we made it. We marinated in flavor, success is premedicated. They irritated cause they know the boy Z is underrated. Check the girls I dated, they asking me like a Sadie's. I hit Jay Giggs, got 20 on the gas. Let's take a trip, put the city on the map. Stage dive in the crowd, nose goes. Getting paid after shows, cash flows, huh? Y'all know me best, I'm something like Ron Artest. Coming mean on the beast, but I'm searching for world peace. The hottest in the hospital, so you know I'm straight illin'. Calculating my takeover just like a villain. Tech, taking over.
I'm taking over. Man, I thought I told you I want it all. Tell your favorite rapper, move over. I'm taking over. Man, I thought I told you I want it all. Tell your favorite rapper, move over.
Japan chillin' with Soto, we never dolo. The Harajuku Barbies, they rush us down for a photo. Ah, like they never seen a nigga in Tokyo. Got some yen for the yang, got strong for the pain. Being 50 made me feel like I need 50 mil. Grinding all night, friends say you better chill. I'm not satisfied, I know how easy feel. A nigga gotta eat, and his music back to pay the bills. Despicable me, turning up in degrees. I'm 23 and I'm looking for girls with them double D's, huh? Thought provoking if you had a thought. Give you tapping in the future, I'm taking former cars out the lot. Bumping knives when I press the button on the knives. Guessing on the track, full take, you can't exhaust. All you got is 24 hours in a day. Jack power doesn't matter, I'm taking over the day. Yeah.
Take, taking over. Take, taking over. Take, taking over. Take, taking over. I'm taking over. Man, I thought I told you I want it all. Tell your favorite rapper, move over. I'm taking over. Man, I thought I told you I want it all. Tell your favorite rapper, move over.
Man, I thought I told you. You want it all, tell your favorite rapper, move over. I'm about to set it off in this motherfucker like Jada Pinkett. Nothing you can tell me, no neutralizing my fucking genius. Fucking genius.
Free stuff for you just for listening to this station.
Yo, we got your attention?
Here's how it works. You click on the radio loyalty banner right now and sign up. Then you keep on listening like you already do. But now you earn points. Those points add up, and you can trade them in for cool stuff in the radio loyalty store. Earn more points by sharing your station with friends on Facebook and Twitter, answering surveys, and by using the apps in the New Players App Store. Pretty simple. Free stuff just for doing what you already do. Radio loyalty. Click the banner to join now.
Welcome to the Real News Network. I'm Paul Jay. The deal that's been struck between the Greek Prime Minister Tsipras and the czars or leaders of the Eurozone has caused shock in Greece, disappointment, and some people relief. They're now going to get some more euros out of their banking machines. The Greek left, some are saying, well, that's what we expected. Others are in mourning, as one person told me. We're going to now go to Athens and talk to a young activist who's been lives in New York most of the time, but she's been in Greece for a while, and she's of Greek descent. Now joining us from Athens is Natina Vagontsis. She's a sociology PhD student at New York University, focusing on political economy and social movements. She's a member of the UAW Graduate Student Organizing Committee and involved in AKNY Greece Solidarity Movement in New York. Thanks very much for joining us, Natina.
Thanks for having me.
Now, just to sort of orient people, you're an activist, and your activism, one could say, is to the left of most of Syriza. Is that, would that be correct?
That'd be correct. I've had a lot of my political education from activists in Andalusia, which is the anti-capitalist front to the left of Syriza. But, you know, that also shares, in terms of political strategy, quite a bit with the left platform. The difference is that they've remained independent of Syriza. And for quite some time, they faced criticism, actually, from activists in the global left for doing that. But we might see, actually, that there's some merit to keeping independence, especially, you know, at this point when the government has capitulated to the demands of the Eurozone.
Right. And the left front being the left front that's within Syriza. So talk about the deal. What are the main points, and what do you think of it?
Yeah, so where to begin? I think one of the biggest concessions is this, you know, kind of blasé-phrased, ambitious primary surplus targets with the addition of quasi-automatic spending cuts. So what this means is that theoretically, if the Greek government doesn't meet the primary surplus target of 2% in 2016, or, you know, all the way to 3.5% in 2018, there are going to be instituted mechanisms for cutting further down on spending. And, you know, even the economics editor, I believe, of Reuters, or I'm sorry, I think it was The Guardian, said that, you know, this is just, you know, continuing a recessionary strategy.
Okay, just to make sure everybody got what you just said. So if they don't run a budgetary surplus of what the number was, what, 2% to begin and then 3.5, you said?
1% in 2015 and then 2 and 3 in 2016 and 17 and then 3.5% in 2018.
And if they don't run that surplus, then these automatic cuts will kick in.
Exactly.
Which you're saying is a recipe for more recession.
Exactly.
One of the most controversial things that came up in the course of the negotiations was this $50 billion fund that would take Greek public assets and convert them into either privatization, or they say run some of them for the purposes of making money. But the money either way, and it seems mostly about privatization, would be 50% used to pay down the debt, 50% for reinvestment. It's not entirely clear who's running that, but it seems it can't be the Greek government, or there wouldn't be any point of having some new structure because the Greek government already controls those assets. What do you make of that? And did you expect that to be a deal breaker?
Yeah, so the details of that are still very murky. You know, this came out of nowhere for many of us. It wasn't included in the Juncker proposal that was rejected in the referendum. It came this week. And initially, the demand from the Eurozone was that these, you know, 50 billion euros worth of assets would be managed and, you know, sold off basically in Luxembourg in this, you know, mechanism called the Institution for Growth, which was actually set up several years ago under the New Democracy government, with also the assistance of the German finance minister, Wolfgang Schäuble, through a German bank on whose board he sits on. You know, it does seem, based on reports that came out, you know, there was this one Financial Times piece that said that by 6 a.m., it seemed that, you know, basically the German and Greek sides had reached an impasse, and had it not been for certain mediators, this might have been a deal breaker. And so at that point, you know, these sleep deprived leaders, you know, went through 10 iterations of what this fund would actually look like. And for now, it seems that it's as you described. But again, you know, we won't know what the final part is. But it really to be added so late in the game, I interpreted it, to be honest, of course, there are material, very real material consequences to it. I think it's going to ensure fully the privatization of the Port of Piraeus, but more symbolically, it's adding humiliation to the defeat.
Because you have essentially some form of loss of sovereignty over how these Greek public assets are going to be disposed of.
Right, exactly.
The reaction, first of all, of people in your circles, describe, and what do you think generally public opinion?
Lots of disappointment, frustration, confusion over why the referendum was held. If, at the end of the day, the government was going to concede. I think my interpretation of the past 5 months is that people were voting for an anti-austerity platform with, of course, the implicit concession that maybe they wouldn't be able to get everything that Syriza was calling for, especially with its Thessaloniki program, addressing the humanitarian crisis of 5 years of austerity. We would hear things like, okay, if they can get 5 of the 15 things that they're aiming for, we understand that this is a tough battle. And so as the negotiations were going on, as the Eurozone was applying, further pressure through liquidity asphyxiation, people thought that it was headed in that way. And I got here in late May. And when you would ask people on the ground, a lot of the people who I talked to, and this is mostly in working class neighborhoods, that's where I do my field work near the Port of Piraeus, they didn't want the government to go back. And I had also been in events where Syriza leadership was speaking and they were being told, don't go back on your promises. And then, the officials would ask, well, what do you want us to do? And people would say, we want some form of confrontation or even, rupture, some people would say. And the government would say specifically, how do you see that? And some people, they would say, as much as it takes. I don't know, what concretely people were thinking when they were saying that, if they meant default, if it meant exit from the Eurozone. But there was a sense that, people were still wanting the government to stay firm, though implicitly, again, I think that there was some understanding that, maybe they would make some concessions. The referendum, though, changed that. The referendum, when Tsipras was presented with this take it or leave it agreement and he left and he took it to the Greek people, there was an understanding that he was going to continue fighting. But based on reports, even from the former finance minister, Varoufakis, where he says that, he entered the prime minister's office after the resounding 62% no victory elated, and instead came to a very somber atmosphere, which meant that the government didn't want to go toward a more confrontational or ruptural scenario, that, in effect, they were going to capitulate. This isn't, I think, something that people were expecting.
What do you make of the reports that they were actually hoping for the yes vote to accept the proposals from the Eurozone? The government was actually hoping that side would win. It would make their life easier.
I don't know. There's a lot of speculation as to what exactly they wanted. I think that because the government was so persistent in a strategy that was exhausting itself very early on and wasn't willing to consider a plan B, which would include anything from internal default within the Eurozone to exiting the monetary union, they, kept hoping that they would be able to create some kind of, disagreement within the ruling bloc of the Eurozone, specifically between the French and German ministers. And it could be that they thought that with this no victory, it was a tactic of desperation, of last resort, maybe they would be able to get something. That's a very, of course, optimistic assessment. It could also be that, they were looking for a no that wasn't as strong, you know, maybe 50 to 55%, that again, they could take to their partners and say, you know, look, are you going to look at democracy in the face and not give us anything? It's hard to know what they actually wanted. But we do know that that night and throughout that week, they were really willing to give up, essentially.
It seems a kind of naivete, in a sense, that they thought that because the Greek people expressed their will, that Eurozone leaders would care. And they certainly had made themselves clear that they didn't care. And Syriza was already elected, which reflected the will of the Greek people. So one wonders why they, if they really thought so, why the referendum would make any difference in the opinion of the Eurozone leaders.
Yeah, I mean, Varoufakis, in this interview that he gave, very revealing. In the new statesman, he said, I think it was taken before the agreement was actually made earlier today. You know, he said that at one point, I asked my partners, you know, why even hold elections in indebted countries? And they didn't even really give him an answer, which he interpreted as, you know, good question.
You hold elections because you're sure you can control the outcome. When you have an election you haven't controlled the outcome of, I guess this is the answer to it.
Yeah, and you could say that when Syriza was elected in January 2015, there was a sense in at least the domestic ruling class that they could control the consequences of that outcome. I don't know if you remember, but there were some interviews made, you know, by very, you know, wealthy, influential people in the country, including, you know, an energy oligarch, Mytilineos, and Bloomberg News, soon after the election results. And they asked him if he was concerned, and he said, no, you know, this government might actually bring us the stability we're looking for, and then we're going to have, you know, stable business conditions, better investment. It could be that they thought that people would be placated enough that, you know, they could get maybe, you know, some version of austerity light and, you know, continue with business as usual.
And one of the arguments that's being made is that this is as good as they could have done, that the Greek people weren't ready to leave the Eurozone. That vote, that no vote, didn't represent a vote for leaving. It just represented a vote, as you said, to keep fighting. But there was no way to win this fight, and that it's better for this austerity plan and the final analysis to be managed by people like Syriza than managed by others. That seems to be the argument that's defending this situation, and that one's being overly critical if you think that Tsipras should have walked from these negotiations, because there was simply nothing to walk to.
Yeah, I think that's a very tricky argument. And we can look at the final hours and we can agree that his options were quite constrained and his lack of preparation made it almost inevitable that he would agree to the terms that he ended up agreeing to. But if we look, you know, at the Greek political process in a bit of a broader sense, if we think about the conditions under which Syriza emerged electorally as a fighting contender in 2012, those were times when, you know, there was a sufficient level of insurgency on the ground. There was a level of conversation in Greek society as to what the options could have been moving forward. You know, I understand the arguments that at that point, you know, people weren't ready. They hadn't expressed their own will to leave the Eurozone. But I think, you know, as you're a rising central political actor, you can start putting these arguments, you know, just opening the conversation. And the leadership never wanted to open that conversation, even when they entered power, even as it seemed that their strategy was being exhausted. You know, there's a very telling moment when in that interview with the New Statesman, Varoufakis says, look, you know, we did take into account contingency measures, and we had a secret group of five people in January who were working on a plan B if it came to that. But the problem is that, one, you have to keep this secret, so it's difficult to expand it to an actually viable operation that's implemented by, say, 500 people in the country, if it were to be actually implemented. But then, you know, and I can understand that argument, but then he kind of waffled and he said, and we didn't have a mandate for that, so of course we couldn't expand to the 500 people. And again, you know, I think that you can pursue a strategy that might be with the common sense of the people at that moment. You can say that we're going to try as hard as we can to negotiate and to remain within the Eurozone, but we must be prepared. And, you know, the results of the February 20th deal showed that they weren't prepared. Varoufakis' own statements showed that they weren't prepared. I think the fact that they weren't prepared was more, you know, out of their own strategic obstinance than, and, you know, that could be easily justified right. over and over by popular will.
Well, from Varoufakis has written that, you know, he was quite committed to the stabilization of European capitalism. And it seems, to, you know, in the final analysis, seems pretty clear. It was naive to think they could have some rational, persuasive powers over European finance.
Right. I mean, I'm still going back to 2012 because I think that was a very critical period. I think European capital wasn't quite sure yet how they were going to handle the crisis. You know, they felt under threat, and it's actually you know, it's quite funny looking back in a tragic sense. The Wolfson Economic Prize, which, you know, is second to the Nobel Economic Prize, was won by a team of HSBC economists who actually drafted as they called it, a practical guide for exiting the Eurozone. And they had a country like Greece, a weak member of the Eurozone, in mind when they drafted it. And at that same time, you know, people like Lapavitsas were also arguing for those kinds of solutions, whereas Varoufakis was very committed to that. And again, in that interview with the New Statesman, he said that when he met Varoufakis, you know, back in 2010, when he met Tsipras, Tsipras himself wasn't, you know, quite firm on the euro versus drachma position. So it might be that Varoufakis actually had quite of an influence on, you know, not just Tsipras' own thinking, but the political strategy of his party. So again, I think it was a bit of a loose question at that point.
It seems to me the roots of this go back to the election campaign itself. That if Syriza had campaigned saying we are going to do everything possible to achieve a dignified, reasonable, moderate deal within the Eurozone that we possibly can, but also say to the Greek people, but if it's impossible, we will create the mechanism to leave. And then if the truth is they couldn't get elected by saying that, if people were so freaked out at the thought of leaving the Eurozone that they wouldn't elected Syriza. Well, isn't it better not to get elected then?
Yeah, I agree. You know, when they were preparing to enter power, because that's really what that period, 2012 to 2015, was, they were visiting, you know, many heads of state. They were visiting different types of think tanks. And their main message was, don't worry, we're not these crazy communists. We're not looking to shake up the whole system. We just have a very simple and reasonable message of anti-austerity. And so, you know, they also went to the Brookings Institute. They went to bankers in London. And over the course of that time, you know, their initial message back in 2012, which was no sacrifices for the euro, ended up, you know, evolving into this, you know, we're moderates. We want to stay in the Eurozone, adding, you know, the Varoufakis flair. We want to actually, you know, make the Eurozone better. We want to save capitalism from itself. And so it kind of spun into that narrative, which I agree, you know, it set itself up for something that wasn't possible given the balance of forces in Europe at this time, which are quite right wing.
One of your research studies is about the rise and growth of the right wing. In Greece, the working class, to a large extent, voted against the Eurozone proposal. What do you think happens next with the Syriza, you would think, a great disillusionment in what they promised? How will this affect the politics, and does it in any way strengthen the right?
Well, As you said in the beginning, there's a great sense of disappointment and frustration today in Athens, but I don't think the left feels fully defeated. And I think, you know, this is in large part due to dissidents within Syriza and outside it. The week, you know, is very young. The parliament still has to pass the measures, which they're expected to do by Wednesday. And there have already been mobilizations called for them. The Public Sector Trade Union Confederation, AVEVI, held a meeting today. And this was a result of interventions by leftist unionists over the course of this period. And the result was the calling for a general strike on Wednesday. And it could happen even sooner if the measures are to be pushed sooner, but that's unlikely. So, the big mobilizations are planned for Wednesday. And it's not just a general strike by public sector workers, but it's also being accompanied with rallies on the streets by civil society organizations, by unions, by neighborhood assemblies, by university and school students. So we'll see. You know, there are always an array of social forces that are released in these kinds of moments. And we have to hope that the rest of the left is going to be able to preserve, the standing of the left with the Greek people. Because one thing that we should note during the week of what some people want to call the Ohi revolt, the no referendum week, was that there was, this sense that the left was starting to gain a certain kind of hegemony within the popular classes in Greece. And this was especially, epitomized by the Friday night rally at Syntagma when Tsipras was due to speak. And of course, that week, again, was a bit suspect for some of us who were watching events unfold, because at the start of the week, we saw that the leadership was starting to send proposals again to the Eurozone. And we were wondering, why call a referendum if you're starting to send proposals again? And this, what we hear, was due to some internal battles within the leadership. Anyway, those were resolved by Wednesday. And by Friday, Syriza was committed to getting a no result. And, at the same time, it hadn't done a lot of preparation to get people out on the street. And, I got there by metro, and I had to wait for three different metro cars to come because there were so many people pouring into it going to Syntagma. And once I got out, I could hear echoes of people chanting, "Ohi, ohi." And once you got into the square, there were, people say over 100,000, maybe up to 200,000 people there. And it was a very different kind of demonstration than the kind that I've been to in Greece, which are usually against the government or against some other kind of government. This was a rally, a political rally in favor of the government. And, people were really cheering on Tsipras, not only Tsipras, other parts of the Syriza leadership, Zoe Kostopoulou, who's the president of parliament. And just based on the people who I talked to there, and they all came from mainly, popular neighborhoods. I asked them if they were organized, and most people said they weren't. They just support the government in this difficult moment. So you could say that at that point, the left was starting to achieve, kind of the trust of people. And the worry is that it's going to lose it very quickly. Again, I think that there are parts of the left that can show that they are willing to fight against this new memorandum, because that's what it is, who are willing to continue to fight, fighting against austerity. And we have to hope that, people are going to take note of those efforts. But again, of course, there is the specter of the far right. And the far right, of course, plays a, it's an anti-systemic force, it's a populist force, but at the same time, it's supported by quite a few interests, from ranging from small to large capital. And you might think that at this point, various parts of the right, from the center to the far right, are going to try to take advantage of the situation. It's very fluid at this point. It's difficult to tell.
All right. Thanks very much for joining us, Natina.
Thanks for having me.
And thank you for joining us on The Real News Network.
Hey, what's going on, Facebook? This is Jerry Royce, live worldwide. We're just coming to you today just to let you know on Tuesday at 8 o'clock, January 6th, we're going to be having the Worldwide One Robin Lynn's production. That's right, Robin Lynn Maven will be on the Jerry Royce Live Show here at Positive Power 21 in Studio 21.2. That's right, she's going to be bringing it. And we're just going to talk a little bit about Robin right now, some of her causes that she supports is civil rights and social action, economic empowerment, education, health, disaster humanitarian relief, poverty alleviation, and social services. As Right and Robin is a guru of teaching about the internet, she's a public speaker, community outreach, leadership development, coaching, team building, strategic planning, and volunteer man. That's just some of the things that she enjoys to do. She never sleeps. She's up all night. If you don't believe me, you can ask her publicist. Anyway, join us tonight. Join us tonight in our virtual studio at 559-726-1300, comma 895-455-pound for access. Or you can wait for our live web stream at 9 o'clock p.m. She will be streaming live with your one and only 2014 Podcast of the Year, a.k.a. Greatest Podcast on Earth, Jerry Royce Live Worldwide. See ya.
Days can be sunny with never a sigh. Don't need what money can buy. Birds in the trees sing their day full of song. Why shouldn't we sing along? I'm a chipper all the day, happy with my lot. Get that way, look at what I've got. I got rhythm, I got music, I got my man. Who could ask for anything more? I got daisies in green pastures, I got my man. Who could ask for anything more? Old man trouble, I don't mind him. You won't find him round my door. I got starlight, I got sweet dreams, I got my man.